Hello and welcome to the Culture Show and our Christmas special. Once again, we're delighted to be with a live audience, and a very live audience because they're drinking tea and coffee and munching mince pies, so please feel free to help yourselves. Our lovely guests will be helping us to feel very festive as we speak to Reverend Jane Nelson, Father Kevin Mullan, Daryl Simpson, and Stephanie Henriquez Quick will also be joining us. And of course, we are the Bob Quick Quintet, and we'll be doing our bit. And we welcome Pete Doherty, who's guesting with us on bass today. So thank you very much, Pete. And we're going to get you mellow. We're going to have a mellow entry into the Christmas holidays, because, I mean, this day week is Christmas Eve, so it's about time we got in there. This is a song called When You Wish Upon a Star. When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are. Anything your heart desires will come to you. If your
Thank you very much.
Very mellow entry. Can you imagine how many dreams are being made and how many wishes are being made, especially in this week? I've come out of primary school, and oh my goodness, some of the wishes, very different to what I was wishing for. We're going to keep sort of in the mood of the children, and this is a lovely song from the Christmas movie Home Alone, and it's called Somewhere in My Memory. That song to Bob, but then I don't know if you do emotion or not, so I thought I better not, because I didn't want to put him off his his train as such. But his gorgeous daughter Stephanie is home from Chile with their first grandchild, and I just thought that was everything. Special people, smiling faces. Now I'm going to get emotional. But it's okay to get emotional, because we are going to welcome our first guests, who are the lovely Reverend Jane Nelson and Father Kevin Mullan.
So you're very welcome.
Thank
back.
You. Thank you.
You are the original stars of the culture show, because you were with us for the first 4 months.
The A team, Jane. The A team.
The Rev team.
The Rev team.
I like it. Thank you for coming back for our Christmas special.
Thank you.
Again, it's a very strange year, but hopefully we're all looking forward to it. And I think my feeling of Christmas last year, it was so strange and bizarre, and everybody was closed down. I think so many people thought that this was going to be happy days, happy holidays, and suddenly we've been confined again. But do you think that from our experience last year, we maybe appreciate different things at Christmas time now? It's not all about the presents, it's not all about the turkey. Do you think maybe our priorities and our wishes and dreams have changed a wee bit. Jane, what do you think?
I think they have, because I suppose before COVID, if we can remember that far back, our focus was very much on our sales and on what we were going to get for Christmas, or what we were going to do at Christmas time, what parties we were going to, what celebrations we were going to have. And COVID then put pay to that, really. I remember it was about this time last year, I think, that we recorded the first culture show.
Yep.
And we were very apprehensive, and then obviously there was a total lockdown over Christmas, but it meant that we did actually focus on what was important, which is family, and our close friends, and also our faith. And hopefully we'll take that through, not just into this Christmas, but into the Christmases that come. But the important thing is the family that are gathered around us, and the faith that we have in God, who's always with us.
Yes. There, you see on social media, there's a picture of a Christmas tree. In fact, I think it's a Snoopy thing. And the caption is, it's not about the presents under the tree, it's who's around the tree, you know. Presents are nice as well.
Oh,
I mean, let's be real. They are. But Father Kevin, what do you think?
Yeah, I was amazed that we find new ways of doing the old things that where we weren't allowed to gather and meet. We said, well, we have to express what's in ourselves. And we find new ways of just creating the joy of Christmas. The whole webcam industry.
Mm-hmm. You've been on webcam.
Out, unfortunately.
I know.
I must tell you. I don't do webcam. I don't have one in my church.
He doesn't have a mobile phone.
No, I don't.
It's fantastic.
I
do admire you. I get very frustrated when I can't contact you, and I want to. But
I'm so happy.
Sorry.
Yes,
sorry, tell us your story.
But I don't like people looking at me making comments. But I ended up in the last 6 weeks, a family member by marriage had died, and somebody who was very well known, and the funeral was in another church, and as a family link I was there, and I was there around the sanctuary and dressed up, and it suddenly dawned to me, this is on a webcam, you know? And I wasn't the principal boy, but I was there. But I was sitting there and I realized there's a spider in my hair. A little itsy witsy teeny weeny thing, you know. And I said, normally I'm on a webcam, I can't be seen to be picking, hitting, or killing a spider. And I sat there. And gradually I got interested in my ear. And then it discovered my neck. And there it was way down the back, my shirt. I was smiling. And eventually I had to get up and do my little bit. So I think it took the opportunity to slip down the sleeve and off it went. But well, it was some. I felt like that lady in the Dickens story who never got married and sat in her house in her white dress, and the cobwebs came round over him. I said, here I am, Father Habersham.
I thought you were going to say, I'm Father Kevin, get me out of here.
I'm a spider, get me out of here.
And Kevin, as always, we had great expectations of you today, and you fulfilled them.
I'm just examining the ear here. I can't see any cobweb. I think we all had to push the boundaries of our ability with technology, which I'm terrible with technology. Mm. What about the difference for you, Bob? From last year, and possibly thinking this is going to be the great hurrah, and then all of a sudden.
Well, yeah, I mean, this year has been the gift that keeps giving. Obviously, in that we were full on with this and with the jazz things in the thrill later on, and the Strabane Brass Band are in here tonight with a gig, and that's just a nightmare. In that all of a sudden this corona thing collapses back on us, and those people can't play because they've tested positive, so you're rushing around trying to get depths and things. So it's been, I think last year for me, organising the sort of work I organise, last year was more relaxing because you knew everything's off, everything's constrained, whereas now we thought it was all good and we've got a foot in both camps, where some of it's good and some of it's not good, you know. So, but Christmas last year was for me, it was a very different affair in that we only had two of our four kids were home, so it felt like a half-empty house to us, whereas this year, everyone's home, so it's absolute.
Plus,
plus herself.
Yes.
Yeah, she who must be obeyed.
And what's to tell us her lovely name?
Amalia Sophia Henriquez Quick.
Lovely. Yes. Very lyrical.
Good luck with learning to spell that when you're in P1.
Well, hopefully she's got her mother, her grandmother's brains.
Ouch. Ouch.
That was good. Well, what we have noticed, Father Kevin, because I've been listening to you in the congregation, is that the numbers, and although we still have the restrictions, the numbers are coming back into the churches, even with the webcams, or our one anyway.
Yes.
Well, obviously.
It's the only way to see them. So.
Yeah. But the numbers have increased
they
over
have,
the past.
They have crept up, you know. And that brings its own concerns in about next week. Will there be too many trying to get in? You don't like to tell people there's no room in the inn for you. we have a number of services and we hope that they will pick and choose, you know.
Yeah. I think we're quite good at, you know, in all of the churches. We have masses or services that are sort of the regular ones for you. And I think even new or people who only go to Mass at special occasions during the year, I think that, you know, I don't think you'll be turning anyone away.
No.
Jane, I hope you're definitely not turning anyone away either.
Well, we're fortunate in that we have the live stream, our equivalent of the webcam, so we can have an overflow into the halls.
Yes.
And people can be accommodated and socially distanced.
Yeah.
But it is a very special time of the year, I think, for families, very nostalgic. I know so many people remember Christmases when they were young and going to church on Christmas morning, and so we want to try to facilitate as many people as would like to come to church, and then the live stream then enables those that maybe feel a little uncomfortable with the crowd still to be able to participate in the service and in the celebration of Christmas.
Yeah. So. And of course an awful lot of people that are missing, you know, that we had never imagined would be as well, but able to go along or even sit at home and feel part of that celebration, you know, still is bound to bring comfort.
Yeah, I think so. I think we've learned that technology can be used for the good, you know, and we've looked at the difficulties and the challenges of COVID and turned some of those into positives. Mm-hmm. And it has helped people actually to re-engage in faith, which we're seeing with people coming to church, maybe after a long period of not being out.
Yeah.
We hope that will continue.
Are you still doing your selfies in the garden or in the kitchen or?
No, only when the government doesn't allow us to meet at the church.
I love that.
And Jenny,
I'm still taking selfies, mind you, but not for services.
Excuse my ignorance on this, but does the webcam in the church continue even after COVID, or was it set up before COVID? I mean, this is not a reaction to COVID.
It is a reaction.
Oh,
yes,
it is a reaction.
Is
and
a reaction.
Will you continue, hopefully, in a couple of years' time when all this is past us?
Yeah. Well, we've been thinking about that, and it's certainly a dilemma because there are perhaps some people who prefer to stay at home than come to church.
Oh, okay.
And obviously, you know, yes, it's important that individuals worship, but we're to worship together.
Yes. Yeah.
So there's debate as to whether we should switch off the live stream whenever social distancing goes.
Okay.
But I've actually seen how people have engaged. Perhaps they would never come through a church door, but they'll watch on the live stream, then maybe be encouraged to come to church.
Yeah.
And also some of the elderly folk who are no longer able to come to church, never mind with COVID, are able to watch the service and still feel part of the congregation and part of the worshiping community. So I think live stream probably is here to stay.
Okay. I think it would be very difficult for it to stop. You know, even in terms of weddings, funerals, very special occasions that people can't actually go to, or they're in another country and can't go to that. I think it would be very difficult to take that away from people again, although I know we're not getting, I don't
that's
think
that's why you never started it, Kevin, isn't it?
Yeah.
Of course, I'm being squeezed. You
know. And you love it.
I mean, we're fortunate to have somebody that can operate it, because I haven't got a clue,
okay,
you know,
yeah.
So I know not everybody's, and sometimes the church is not designed in a way that facilitates it or has the internet that enables it to happen. So we are grateful for those mercies.
Yeah.
Lovely.
Yeah.
It's been so lovely that you have come back to us. Do you remember whenever we said to
Father Kevin and Reverend Jane at their last
yes.
show. They did 4 months. You came in 4 months for us, which was great. And then when we just said, maybe you'd come back and do a Christmas special.
I remember.
The faces.
It wasn't a good reaction, Jane.
It wasn't a good reaction. The faces just fell.
Yeah.
But we're very, very grateful that you did come back. And thank you so much.
Thank
and so delighted that we have a live audience
yes. Hello.
As well. Munching their way through the mince pies. But I'm sure you have something profound or lovely to say to us as we prepare for Christmas. This will be going out a few days before Christmas, so I know you'll have something gorgeous to say.
Oh, no, I'm going to reserve it for those who are brave enough to come and sit in front of me. But I just...
Very good.
But... No, I was very, very moved last night. I came in quite late because we had a lovely man died and spent an evening in the family and checked the messages. And there was a message, garbled sound, and I played it again. What did he said, this is James. Now, James was a rogue. James was a total rascal when I was in his parish, you know, and I rescued him from all kinds of things, and we were good friends, and he's in Australia, and he just very brief message says, hello Kevin, this is James, I've just been saying my prayers, and he's 39 or something like that, and I thought of you and I must give you a ring.
Oh.
I'll ring you back. I just
that's
do you know,
lovely.
Yeah, he's on his second marriage, he's changed
we'll
jobs.
Not get into that.
And I think he's going to settle in Australia forever and ever and ever. But he remembers, you know.
That's
lovely. And Christmas, I think people do remember.
Yeah.
And I went to bed happy.
Oh, that's
yeah.
lovely.
Yeah.
That is lovely.
Must save up now to phone him back.
Oh, just reverse the charges. I think you can still do that. And Jane, I'm sure you're looking forward to seeing family and
yeah,
friends.
Yeah, very much so. But I was thinking about what to share with you today, and I thought about, this has been a year or 18 months of waiting, you know, waiting for things to improve, waiting for things to change, and Advent is a season of waiting as well, so I thought about the word wait, and so a little thought for each of the letters.
Lovely.
The first one is to welcome each new day, because I think during the pandemic we've really come to appreciate life, and each day as it happens, you know, so to welcome each new day. And then the second one, obviously, is A, and that is to think about our blessings that God has given to us, thinking about our family and our friends, and to appreciate that. So it's appreciate okay. your blessings every day. And then I is to invest. And we've realised how much people have invested in others over this last year, being willing to serve others, those in the health service, mm-hmm. those in our shops and in our various schools and universities and in the churches. And so to invest in the people that we have in our lives, our family and our friends, and to do what we can to help them. And then finally, T, to trust in God, to know that God is present with us and he will bring us through this to a brighter day. So we celebrate the Christmas season, but waiting is a time that we do in Advent, waiting for the coming of Jesus. And so let's do that.
Oh, that's lovely. That's a lovely thought. Thank you very much. Thank you so much for joining us. And we have a very appropriate song that we're going to cross over to now, and it's called A Child Is Born.
Ah, oh, lovely. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben. Thank you, Reverend Jane.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Child, innocent child. Song before until we started working on it a few weeks ago. It was gorgeous. Now we're going to continue on with the most wonderful time of the year, because that's what we're getting into. It's the most wonderful time. The kids jingle belling and everyone telling you be of good cheer. It's the most wonderful time of the year. It's the happiest season of all, with those Christmases long, long ago. It's the most wonderful time of the year. There'll be much mistletoeing and hearts will be glowing when loved ones are near. It's the most wonderful time of the year. Thank you very much. We are now going to have a chat to the lovely Stephanie, and we'll go over her surname whenever we get chatting to her. So we shall welcome Stephanie.
So here we are with two ladies in my life, or two of the many ladies in my life, I should say.
Hello.
And these two ladies have something in common in that they have both Christmased for many years in the Southern Hemisphere. So we're going to talk about the differences between Northern Hemispheres and Southern Hemispheres. First of all, it's my daughter Stephanie, if you didn't realise that, recently got married, and her name in Chile, which is where Stephanie and her husband lived for the last 4 or 5 years, when you get married, you don't do what Europeans do, you combine the two names. So Stephanie's married name is Stephanie Henriquez Quick. Is that right, Stephanie Henriquez
it's a
Quick?
Mouthful, but yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
So you take on so, the husband's surname, and then you add on your maiden name.
Okay. So the logic that is if that was true in Ireland, Gerda would be Gerda McCann Gallagly.
No, I wouldn't.
Would you not? Gerda Gallagly
oh,
McCann.
Oh, I would. No, I would. I'd be Gerda Gallagly McCann.
Okay.
Yeah. But Gerda McCann.
If my wife had done that, her maiden name was Kidd, she would be Melanie Kidd Quick. Or Melanie Quick Kidd, which doesn't work so well. I grew up with a neighbour of mine in Yorkshire with a Yorkshire name. She was a young lady about my age, and their family name was Go-to-Bed. So if I'd married her, she would have been Susie Quick Go-to-Bed, which would give you all sorts of problems, isn't it? So it's probably best that we don't adopt that in there. But so, Stephanie, first of all, my love, what's describe Christmas in Chile and the differences between European Christmases and South American Christmases.
Do you know, I think the main difference would be something that Gerda will touch on as well with the seasons. So we're all used to the white Christmas or grey Christmas, depending on what winter we're getting. But the main difference I would find is where we're all getting into our snuggly scarves and, you know, Christmas patterned pyjamas over there, you're getting out your swimwear and you're looking for your beach towels. So for me, that's just bizarre because, you know, you're just getting... You're buying Christmas presents, but you're also looking for the sun cream, and you know. So there's that sense of it.
And in Chile, is it like in Australia, where you go into the shopping malls and things, and there's fake snow, and there's Santa all dressed up, and there's reindeer, and there are snowmen, and like
it's
that, people are walking around in shorts and sunglasses.
Yeah.
And all. Is it like that in Chile as well?
Yeah, it would be. It would be, especially you were. I think you mentioned the shopping centres and the shops. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you might not get as many events or Christmas kind of themed shows going on in art centres like this, but the big pull is in the shopping centres, in the malls, and you would get people dressed up. Or the summer version of a Santa Claus, which is, you know, sore on the eyes.
I would say.
heading on to the beach as well for a wee break. So, but they're big into decoration as well. They do they do celebrate it similarly to here.
Well, definitely with Australia. I mean, Australia grew out of Westerners,
convicts.
Really.
Yeah. Convicts.
I was trying to be very gentle.
Okay.
So with... what they were thinking, you know, they were just having a normal Christmas, but on the other side of the world.
Yeah.
What about Chile's not really like that, though, is it?
You mean following traditions, like kind of copycatting?
Mm-hmm.
I would say they would be to a certain extent. I see that on the commercial side of it, big on presents. Presents is a big deal. But I think the Catholic influence comes in when they celebrate on the 24th instead of the 25th. So that would be the main difference there.
Mm-hmm.
And even I was horrified to hear that most families would open the presents on the 24th. So you wake up on the 25th, and what are you going to do? Well, you play with the toys. You eat. You do. So the influence there would maybe not be as seen as much, because it depends on the families and what traditions they follow. But I think a lot of the traditions are very similar. You have little details that might be different.
Mm-hmm.
So
and is there more emphasis, Steph, on the religious side then? Because for us it's very much it's a clash between the religious side and the secular side.
Yeah, again, it depends on the family, doesn't it?
Okay.
But the majority of the population over there, obviously Catholic.
Yeah.
And I would feel like the dominant influence in Christmas in general is religion.
Okay.
Which is why they fall on the 24th. All the important events within the family, the big meals on the 24th, the presents, because they go to the Mass. So the Mass is on the 24th in the evening.
Mm-hmm.
Then they come home and the mums hopefully set up the cooking, the turkey, whatever they're going to eat, so it's ready when you get home.
And is it turkey?
Depends on the family.
Okay.
Not as much as you would think. I think a lot of families try to copy the Western style, the big turkey, or maybe a chicken. But for example, my husband's family would just do whatever they fancy. They'll have a chat that year and say, right, what do we fancy? Do you know, I'm really into seafood this year. Or, you know, I really want one of your curries.
You see, there's the real option for seafood as well, because that would be very big in Australia. You know, that would be a huge thing, that instead of having a big roast turkey, that, you know, and seafood is so accessible as well.
Mm-hmm. And also with a heat wave, if you're getting a heat wave, if you're lucky enough to, in Australia and Chile, it's very likely that time of year. You might not fancy hot spuds and a big turkey. You know, you might be more in the mood for a salad with some fresh fish or, you know, whatever. Yeah.
Very easy to get food poisoned, though, with fish in hot weather. I suffered it twice.
Have you? In Australia?
Holy moly.
Yeah, no, you would not that at Christmas.
You need to take more drink with it, Gerard. Drink stops the food poisoning.
Does it?
Oh, absolutely.
Red wine in particular?
Oh, yeah.
Is that your mulled wine?
Yeah, absolutely.
Medicinal mulled wine?
Yeah.
Can you get a prescription for that?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. It's free on the NHS. You can get it injected straight in for you.
Oh, with the booster?
Yeah, a red wine booster.
Fourth booster coming out for Bob Quick.
And for both Australia and Chile, then, it must be a strange thing, because this is very much, apart from a Christian festival, this is very much our midwinter gig, if you like, that gets you through midwinter. But in Australia and Chile, you don't have the equivalent in your midwinter.
No, I was thinking of that. In Australia, is there anything?
We do Christmas in July.
You do not?
Yeah.
So, two Christmas.
I do Christmas in July.
No.
I think it was very common among lots of the Irish, and I obviously knew a lot of Irish people there, English, Scottish people and that, but some years I would throw a Christmas in July.
Right.
It didn't have to be the 25th of July, but it was great because it was cold outside and able to. And
just picking up the spirit a bit, isn't just the dark days.
Just do a kringle. It doesn't have to be Chris anything. But it was like pretending it was Christmas because it was cold.
And apart from that, was there anything else they would have celebrated? Any other national holiday? Any other excuse to...
The Aussies don't really need excuses.
Right.
They absolutely love partying. Yeah. I always...
So why did you come back then?
I know. I would always say about Australians, they work really hard and they party really hard.
Yeah.
And I love that. And the other thing I have to say about Australians as well is that I found there was no real class system.
Okay.
You know, everybody worked very hard and partied, but you would have found the solicitor or the doctor or the surgeon at the same party as someone who worked in, you know, someone who worked in one of the shops or, you know, where... Very important jobs, like everything is, keeping the country going. But that's what I loved about it. And I think the warm weather and being able to depend on good weather, I think that really helps, because people get outside and relax outside.
Yeah.
And there's not the confines always of suits and jackets.
No.
And that can be a barrier.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So and in the wintertime in Chile, of course, if you go far enough south where you lived eventually, it gets very cold, doesn't it, in the wintertime?
Oh, yeah. I mean it's... Where we were recently, their winter would be similar to what it is here. And if you go further down south to Patagonia, I mean, it's...
Yes.
Donegal style kind of gale force winds.
That bad?
Right, And also the 4 o'clock, you've lost the daylight, you know?
Yes.
Four o'clock?
Yeah, that would be the same.
Oh, yeah. Just like, 4 o'clock.
Jed is very observant about these things.
Well, the lights in my car come on automatically when I get started.
I don't realise it is that early here.
In the depth of winter, yes. Yeah. I think of it as kids coming home from school.
Yes.
You know, they're sort of going to school in the dark, coming home from school in the dark. Yeah. So what are you looking forward to in terms of a family Christmas back in your home with your daughter, who I've had the privilege of seeing, and oh my God, she is so gorgeous. Mm-hmm. It's bound to be...
It's been a long time
amazing.
Coming.
Yeah.
I mean, even before, obviously now because of the year that we've all had, or the 2 years, it's been 2 years since we've been together.
Yeah.
And then we've got, you know, various... I've got one of the brothers is in Amsterdam at the minute, and Danny's up in Belfast, so it's just eventually getting everyone together. Christmas is a good excuse to get us all together, but it's getting everyone in the same house for more than a day, you know, for a couple of days I have to stay.
Yeah.
And just with the wee one, just inventing new traditions, so pulling together the quick traditions, obviously, we've had from young, and recreating that with Mally, the baby, and then also, you know...
Is that what you call her, Mally? Amalia.
Amalia or Mally. We get Mally.
Lovely.
Version. And just seeing what we can come up with, you know, mixing our traditions with Carlos's, my husband, the Chilean influence, and then a couple of new ones as well.
And I suppose it's remembering too that this is all totally new to Carlos.
Yes.
Now,
that's
you know,
the thing. Yeah.
You're going to be all like, oh, we're back to what we love. And actually, Carlos might be thinking, hold on, what is going on?
It's baby fever, isn't it, in the house when you give a new baby, first grandchild, first Christmas in a while with a wee one. And every so often I look up and I think, oh, wait a minute, you're in a new continent as well. So it'll be interesting for him to see.
Yeah.
He seems to have taken to the drinking okay, doesn't he?
I mean, it wasn't easy at the start, but
he
helped
him. No,
he's always... I was going to say, are you leading by example?
Oh, always. Always.
Disaster, yeah. Guinness has been tried and tested. Seal of approval.
Seal of approval,
oh, very
excellent.
Much so, yeah. And what was it the other day? Well, the Ulster Fry.
Ulster Fry.
Oh, wow.
It's apparently gone down very well.
So, I would say. Yeah. Possibly not together.
Well, I don't know. I mean, he's following suit, so...
Yeah, okay, maybe. Do you know what's interesting? Talking about the comparisons of Christmases on one side of the world as opposed to the other. And of course, we do focus on, you know, on the food, on the commercialism, on the weather and that. But I suppose the big thing that brings everyone together, if you have faith, is Christmas, you know, is the birth of Jesus, which would be huge, of course. In Chile.
In South America,
I wonder, is that why they celebrate with food and presents on the 24th to keep the 25th? Maybe the focus is on going... Oh, no, they go to Mass on the 24th, is that what you said?
No, I think because the focus is on the Catholic side of it for most of them, the Mass has always fallen on the 24th. So then I think it's the idea of getting the kids from a young age excited. This is what I've seen with Carlos's nephew anyway. Getting the kids excited to go to Mass, which, you know, once they're there, they enjoy it.
Okay.
But then saying, oh, but then after we've got presents in the meal. You know, it's kind of the package deal.
Yes.
Which makes sense when you're there. It feels lovely and it's a lovely evening. But it's just in my head on the 25th.
What did you do on the 25th?
Well, his family's about the only family I've met over there that opened presents on the 25th.
Okay.
So, that was all right.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Good. Have you your shopping done?
Almost.
Bearing in mind that you're...
Almost.
Gorgeous daughter and granddaughter are at home.
Oh, all that shopping is done.
All
the toys for Amalia are bought, can I tell you?
Excellent. Yeah, excellent.
From about June, by the sense.
About then.
We started early this year.
Yeah.
It'll be wrapping paper city in your living room, no doubt.
But you're getting a trombone, obviously. I mean, you can't have a trombone too early.
And that's hard to wrap. Probably just put it in a box, maybe.
Yeah, maybe. Thank you so much for coming into
the
Culture Show.
Thank
Great
you
to have you here. I had been talking about one of the songs we did earlier from Home Alone, which is somewhere in my memory. And I just thought it just encapsulated everything about the Christmas in the Quick household, because it was special moments, special people, and the magic of having the babe and everything there as well.
Yep.
So lovely, lovely to have you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
And Merry Christmas to you too.
Merry Christmas.
Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Hopefully see you beforehand, don't think we will, as well. Thank you. You gave me when we said goodbye. walking on by with these masks. You're trying to decipher people by their eyes, which is not always great. Well, maybe there's sometimes people you're quite happy walk on by. Our next song is another lovely Christmas song that probably isn't commonly known, and it's called Christmas Time Is Here.
1, 2, 3.
Simpson. Daryl is from Omagh, where he studied at the Omagh Academy before studying music at Queen's University Belfast, the Royal Irish Academy of Music and the Royal Scottish Academy of Music. Daryl has had a varied and distinguished career in music. He's perhaps best known as a member of the Celtic Tenors and as the founder of the Omagh Community Youth Choir, which was formed in the aftermath of the Omagh bomb to promote peace and reconciliation through music. Daryl, it's fantastic to have you here with us.
Thank you,
I usually like to start by asking my guests about their time at school and whether books and literature played an important part at that stage of their life.
Yeah, I think looking back now, I had a very fond memories of school, certainly, especially at Omagh Academy. And there was a certain amount of license and freedom to go and try things, which I wonder nowadays, would that be possible within the confines of COVID and everything else? But certainly there were lots of books on the agenda through English literature. And of course, I had Kate Hines as my English teacher, so no better woman to encourage young folk to read. And I think now as I've got older, I see the opportunities afforded to me by by reading lots of books and literature, because it expands your imagination, and if nothing else, it gives you ambition to want to do things too.
Well, one of the books you're going to talk about is Of Mice and Men, which I think a lot of people will have memories of studying and reading at school. So what's your perspective of it?
I think it was very much on our GCSE syllabus at the time. And I remember fondly, in fact, I went back to the book a couple of years ago to read it. I'd also watched the wonderful movie that was made of it too, 10, 15 years back. And for me, it was, I guess, the experience of America in the Great Depression. I travel to America quite a lot, usually 3-4 times a year, you know, really since I left school, bar this last couple of years with COVID. And I always wanted to put myself in the position of Lenny and George, you know, as they traveled up and down California and going from place to place, looking for work during the Depression. And I think in some ways there's still an element of that in California. And when you spend time there outside of the big cities, of course, Los Angeles, and everyone thinks of Hollywood, and maybe even San Diego, San Francisco, but in between, you have vast stretches of, you know, farmland and forest, as we know now from the big forest fires.
And is that an important aspect of reading and of literature for you, sort of pairing it with your own experiences and places you've been maybe, and then reading about those places and blending the two?
Yeah, I think very much so, because you're trying to get inside the mind of what the reader is, or the writer is portraying, and in this case, I mean, John Steinbeck was a master craftsman, really. I mean, in some ways, I kind of felt, and of course it is a play, but it was written as a play come story at the same time. So it was very cleverly put there, where the nuances of the words, of the spoken word and the text, which was probably quite controversial at the time, it still resonates with me. And I think when you can see yourself in that position, say on the farm, as the boys were planting alfalfa, and this was their big dream to own their own ranch and things, then that's an important part of experiencing it. You know, for me, reading should be an experiential kind of process, where you kind of feel that you are there, in fact. And now that I have kids and I'm reading stories to them, I'm finding the same thing. I'm trying to get that across to them. Imagine what it would be like if you were there. How would that feel? What are the sights, the smells, the meanings, the feelings? So that was really my memories of Mice and Men. You know, it's a story which is actually very, very sad, but it talks about a great friendship between these two guys. And, you know, I guess, you know, when you look at it in today's context, you know, the whole process of human isolation, and we have a very different type of isolation. We're nearly in a great depression in some ways of our own because of the pandemic. So there is certainly strong parallels to be drawn with pretty much 100 years ago.
And when you talk like that, because it's something that's come up over the course of a couple of these interviews, of that crucial aspect of reading as a form of empathy with people, and I'm seeing an empathy that's something that isn't too prevalent in a lot of, you know, society and politics, for example, today. And when you talk about even about reading to your children and teaching empathy that way, it's a...
Well, very much so, but even within Mice and Men, you know, the language is quite vulgar, there's a lot of racism, there's, you know, things that are high up in present-day context, so it's understanding where that is in our society, and expressing, I suppose, this isn't okay, you know, and I think maybe that was one of the reasons why Mice and Men was put on the GCSE syllabus, because it was encouraging young people to think about that more, rather than just say, oh, well, that's acceptable behaviour, so I can do that. You know, that's not the case. Just because you can doesn't mean you should.
If we stick a bit with your education, you went from the Home Academy to study music at Queen's.
Yes.
And then you continued your musical education with a focus on opera.
Uh-huh.
I believe, I wonder if you could talk to us a bit about operas and reading opera and reading yeah. librettos and then obviously watching them and performing them. How does that all, in terms of taking it in and learning it, where does reading the actual text fit in that whole process?
I think again, there's a lot of layers within that. I mean, ultimately opera is storytelling. In a grandiose way, some might say it's a bit over the top, and I think it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be out of this world, and that idea of people coming to the theatre and escaping for 2 or 3 hours, or 5 if it's Wagner, on a good night. but as an actual performer, it's multi-layered. So yes, you'll start with the music and the libretto, and trying to understand the background of the characters. And where it's coming from, because sometimes even with an aria, you're only expressing 1 or 2 emotions within, say, 3 or 4 minutes. So you need to have a lot of nuance within that. Like, how many times can I say I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you? You know, there's a lot of work to be, I suppose, squeezed out, ringed out, within that. But I've enjoyed the fact that it's forced me to look at other languages, Italian, French, German, and even our own English. Sometimes we don't realise how difficult it is to actually sing proper English on a stage without a microphone. And the stories for me are important, because I think nearly always there's a life lesson within them as well. And yes, it's maybe seen as a high art in many ways, but I mean, I've come from a working family here in Oma. We had no experience of opera, and once I started to work within that area, I just fell in love with it. And my parents and my family came along and watched a lot of the performances and loved it. And I was really fortunate to be accepted then in Zurich Opera House as a young artist. So that totally opened my experiences again, to go and live in a very different country, very wealthy city, very wealthy opera house with basically the greatest opera singers on the planet coming in and out every week. I often make the kind of similarities a bit like maybe signing to Barcelona as a footballer or something like that, where you're amongst the best. So it brings your own level up. And that was an experience that I thoroughly, thoroughly enjoyed.
The next book we're going to talk about is The Rat Pack Confidential, by Sean Levy. It's a book about Frank Sinatra and his contemporaries, I believe, around Las Vegas.
Yeah, very, very much so. And I think everybody knows this, the idea of the Rat Pack and these guys hanging out and being super cool, and the music's fantastic and the movies are great in Las Vegas. For whatever reason, I think I've always had a love affair with America since I was a kid. And certainly, looking back on the movies and the music of the Rat Pack, I always loved it. Probably when it wasn't cool for a 13 or 14 year old to be listening to Frank Sinatra, I was listening to it, and still do. So this kind of story, I think for me, was more to find out more about who they were, where did they come from, how did they come to this kind of godlike stature within the entertainment business. And as we now know, again, it was multifaceted and layered, where they were kind of kingpins in many ways. They were connected to maybe not so good guys with the mob. They were connected certainly politically very high with the likes of the Kennedys. And there was, a real intrigue for me. Again, having done shows in Las Vegas and spent time there, you wonder what the early days were like. And this portrayal kind of gives an insight. And from what I understand, it's a very close reality to how these guys lived. And it wasn't always what we see on TV either. I think there was probably a lot of narcissism and selfishness, and certainly racism. I couldn't believe it, you know, reading that Sammy Davis Jr., who was a headliner in many of these places, wasn't even afforded the opportunity to stay in the hotel that he was working in because they had a no blacks policy at the time. And you know, when you think of how far African American history has come in America, to think that even in the 50s and 60s that was still the case, it still rings very hollow for me, and I'm very sad because I think that Sammy Davis Jr. was possibly one of the greatest entertainers that ever lived, and to be treated like that. But to be fair to Sinatra, he stood up for him and I think opened the way in some ways. But it was an interesting insight in the kind of the lunacy and extravagant lifestyles that these guys have, where money was no option, and you know, everything I guess that we thought they did do, and maybe much more as well.
And I wanted to ask you, because if we think of you, maybe when you read that book and you know you had that, you know, fascination with Sinatra, and you're also studying and performing opera, what were your, at that stage in your life and career, maybe 15, 20 years ago, what were your ambitions? Did you have a sort of an idea of a plan, or were you just exploring the opportunities as they came to you?
Well, when I look back to going to Queens, I went in as a pianist. I hadn't, you know, I really didn't do any singing at all at the Academy. I wasn't really interested in singing, bar sticking a CD on one day with Pavarotti, singing Ness and Dorma, and saying, can I sing that note? And I probably squawked it out, but it wasn't very good. And that was it, literally. I ended up going to Queens, and by default got sucked into going to chamber choir and things like that. And all of a sudden, the experience really was changing how I was feeling about things, and I loved it. Still do, I love choir singing, I love being in an ensemble and performing like that. And the more interested that I got, the more ambitious I wanted. You know, I went from being a choir singer, I wanted to be a soloist, and then from soloist I wanted to be an opera singer. And I remember at the time my professor, Jan Schmatzny, was very clear with me. He said, look, I think you've got a voice there, but you're going to have to go on a heck of a journey here now if you want to get the end result to be an opera singer. And upon leaving Queens, I think he said, look, you've got 5 or 6 years of training ahead of you. Which to me, I kind of thought, that's kind of crazy. But he was right, and that is the reality of it. I feel a bit sad nowadays when I see, you know, young singers coming out of college and going to conservatoires, because at least in my day, a lot of the funding was there to cover you. Nowadays, people are coming out carrying lots of debt, and you know, to pursue something like opera maybe is not as accessible if you're coming from, you know, a lower income background. So I would hope that maybe there's a balancing act now soon again, that people realise the arts are very important and that the opportunities should be afforded to everybody, not maybe just the richer in society.
Well, one of the opportunities that we see locally and with local young people is of course the Doma Community Youth Choir. And that was when I was, you know, sort of preparing for this, it sort of hadn't struck me before. Obviously everyone's aware of the choir, yeah, and you're almost synonymous with it in many ways, having set it up. I was struck by how, I mean, you would have set it up as a young man back when that happened, and it was a very, obviously, like a noble pursuit and an admirable one, particularly for a young person to take on. Oh, just could you talk to that, yeah, product, and tell us a bit about that, yeah, process?
There's something about being young and naive, you know, and I thought about this recently. I'd literally had just graduated from Queens. Unfortunately, the Oma bomb happened, and everybody knows the devastation that caused. And like many people, I was here in the town that day, and within a few days, I felt I really had a compulsion to do something positive. And the only thing that I was trained to do, obviously, was music. And I knew that the kind of, again, reflecting on where I was, I hadn't really had the opportunity to sing when I was in Oma. And I thought, well, maybe that's an opportunity. When you bring voices together to sing, you know, there's a pureness, there's an empathy, there's an understanding. And at the time, I kind of felt that it might be a gentle way of providing some solace to people here locally. And as things turned out, you know, 22 years later, you know, the choir's been a great success, as and in fact is now a charity. But I think what makes me very happy is when I look down through it, yes, there has been many who've gone on to have careers in music, which you have to be very proud of, but there's many who've taken the message out into their own careers, should they have been doctors or lawyers or teachers or whatever they have, of bringing that empathy that, you know, that they learned through the choir. And I guess just treating people with a bit of decency and understanding that, you know, not every day is a good day for folk, and that sometimes you just need to put an arm around somebody and say, you know, are you okay? And hopefully the choir was a nice way of doing that. The message certainly came through the music, but also we worked tirelessly behind the scenes to make sure that our young people understood that, and that was one of the reasons why we wanted to tour internationally, because that gave us a real strong opportunity to do that. So even on our last trip to Nashville, we took them to perform in retirement homes and places like that, where they were doing a service to communities, and that was very high in our agenda. You know, not just doing the nice things, let's say, like we performed at that point at the Country Music Hall of Fame, which was amazing, what an opportunity. But it's also important to show, you know, to do normal things and to go in to see people. And in many ways, looking back on it, the kids enjoyed the service projects as much as they did the big kind of important performance opportunity. So that, you know, that was great that they got to experience that.
Wonderful. I want to finish by asking you about the Celtic Tenors. I'm allowed to tell us a bit about that. Yeah. How important has that been in your career, and where does that sort of sit in the work you've done?
Well, it's been a huge part of my life now. I think when I left Zurich, I joined the Celtic Tenors initially for a year, and I was to go back to Zurich after that. The Opera House very kindly had given me permission for a year to go out, and lo and behold, 15, 16 years later, I'm still with the Celtic Tenors, and thankfully I'm still on good terms with Zurich as well, which is good. But it's been huge, and in many ways it's been an extension of the choir for me in some ways, because we felt that we were representative of both Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland, North, South, Protestant, Catholic, and giving a positive message about the island of Ireland. I think just looking back through records the other day, I think we've performed in something like 40 different countries worldwide. Obviously the States and Canada and Europe are the big ones, and Australia, New Zealand, and even Middle East. But we've gone to obscure places. In some ways, you know, like we did a major tour of China at one point. And I say obscure because at the time, nobody was doing tours of China. And we ended up touring with a symphony orchestra for 4 weeks to cities that had 8-9 million people. And I'd never heard of these cities. It gave me a reality check of how big and vast a country it was, you know. So I honestly have to say it's been a huge part of shaping how I feel and think about things too, and you know, we've had ups and downs like all major you know, professional groups. We've had good times and bad times, we've had good management, we've had bad management, we've, you know, had to learn the lessons as we go along, and I think that's part of the process, that's part of the journey. And you know, we're celebrating 20 years as a group this year, and it's been difficult, obviously, with COVID. We haven't performed. We've done one public show in 2 years. We were dragged off the stage in Pittsburgh 2 years ago, and that was it. We had to get a flight home. So it's been difficult. It's been difficult to keep motivated, But we're obviously we're performing here on the 30th, and as a kind of après Christmas, just everybody can relax and enjoy some music. We'll do some Christmas music, absolutely, and we'll do some of the Celtic tenor classics as well. And it'll be a lovely kind of informal way of us getting back on the stage and sharing our music, and again maybe trying to just forget about how difficult things have been, even subliminally. You know, people have experienced a huge amount of stress and trauma this past 18 months, 2 years. So I do think that the arts are the cure to many of those things, in that it helps you just escape to somewhere else, even if it's only for 2 or 3 hours, that might be enough.
Well, Daryl, thank you very much for being here. You've given us plenty to think about, both in terms of what you've read and the fantastic work you've done, and I'm sure we'll all look forward to seeing you back on stage soon.
Not at all, Andrew. Thank you very much, and happy Christmas to everybody.
So we've come to the last few numbers for this Christmas special of the Culture Show. This next song was made famous by the Carpenters. And there is a backstory to it. It's called Merry Christmas, Darling. And when we were rehearsing 1 week, and this was going to be the next song, Bob just got off his seat, walked across the rehearsal room, looked at Paul and said, Merry Christmas, Darling. And I remember thinking, how lovely of you. So this is especially for Paul and Bob.
Your head's a strange place, Jenny, you know that.
Greeting cards have all been sent. The Christmas rush is through, but I still have one wish to make, especially for you. Thank you.
thank you so much. We've come to our last song. So I would just love to thank you so much for coming along and joining us live here in the Strulong Centre. Thank you to everyone who's watching online. I'd also like to thank all of our guests, Reverend Jane Nelson, Father Kevin Mullan, Daryl Simpson, the gorgeous Stephanie...
Henriquez Quick.
I knew I was going to say it wrong. Thank you so much, Stephanie, for coming in and entertaining us. Thank you also to our sound and vision team headed by David Doonan. And of course, all of this is only made possible by the support from the Good Relations Council Department of Uma and Fermanagh District Council, plus the Community Relations Council. So on behalf of the Culture Show, we wish you a very safe and happy Christmas. And we're going to end with Sleigh Ride.
Merry Christmas, everyone!